When Arthur Conan Doyle created his great detective, he needed an equally great adversary, a criminal genius who would rival the greatest mind of his generation, of any generation. And where could he find the inspiration for such a man? From the very detectives who sought such an outlaw. Case number 23, the real-life inspiration for Professor Moriarty. Today, on the Noir Factory.
Noir, suspense, true crime, hard-boiled fiction. Explore the dark alleys and cheap gin joints of mob history, noir films, hard-boiled paperbacks, and two-fisted pulp fiction with mystery writer and make-believe detective Stephen Gomez. Grab your fedora and button your lip as you enter the office of the internet's finest fictional detective agency, the Noir Factory.
He is the Napoleon of crime, Watson. He is the organizer of half that is evil and nearly all that is indetectable in the great city. He is a genius, a philosopher, an abstract thinker. He has a brain of the first order. He sits motionless, like a spider in the center of its web. But that web has 1,000 radiations, and he knows very well every quiver of each of them. He does little himself. He only plans. Arthur Conan Doyle. He was the world's greatest detective, but what did that mean if he went up against purse snatchers and sneak thieves? He matched wits with the best criminals of London, but how impressive was that if you always came up on top? If you always won? Doyle's detective bored quickly, and he needed the game to keep his senses sharp, his intellect keen. So if you are Arthur Conan Doyle, and you have the great Sherlock Holmes at your disposal, you don't need a good villain, or even a brilliant foe. You need the greatest criminal mind ever. You need the man Scotland Yard dubbed the Napoleon of crime. Adam Worth was born to a Jewish family in Germany in 1844 and traveled with his parents to America 5 years later. The Worth family settled in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and Adam's father was a tailor, and young Adam helped around the shop. When he was 5 years old, young Adam was conned into trading 2 old dull pennies for 1 bright shiny new one. Adam's father beat the boy for falling for the trick, and even at that early tender age, Adam Worth vowed that no one would ever get the better of Adam Worth in any business transaction, regular or irregular. Adam briefly worked an honest job, what he called his first and only honest job, at a department store before he enlisted in the Union Army at the age of 17. He craved adventure, excitement, and of course the $1,000 enlistment bonus the North paid to their new soldiers. Adam lied about his age, and he served in the 34th New York Light Artillery Regiment, working his way up to sergeant. But at the Second Battle of Bull Run in August of 1892, Adam was technically killed. You know, mostly dead. Adam was seriously wounded, and he was sent to a hospital to recover. It was there that he found he was listed as killed in action. So in his mind, there was no reason for Adam Worth not to re-enlist and take advantage of the signing bonus the North offered. But now, Adam was developing a taste for it, and he repeatedly deserted and joined up, collecting bonuses from either side as he went. After the war, Adam eluded the consequences of his bounty jumping and made his way to New York. He worked, for lack of a better word, as a pickpocket, and found that he had skills for this as well. He worked sober, he avoided excess, and he acted in a professional manner. Soon, he was running a gang of pickpockets and sneak thieves. When he chose to steal a cash box from an Adams Express stagecoach, however, he bit off more than he could chew. He was caught, and he was sentenced to 3 years hard labor in Sing Sing Prison. Sing Sing was a puritanical prison that worked their prisoners for 10-hour shifts and forbid them from speaking. It was there Adam was given the job of standing over an open fire to warm the frozen nitroglycerin used to blast the marble from nearby quarries. He did this for weeks before a fellow prisoner let him know how dangerous it was. As soon as he got the chance, he escaped by stowing away on a tugboat. Back in New York, Adam continued to rise in stature in the thriving criminal underground. Again learning a hard lesson, he vowed never to go to jail again and focused on more well-organized and profitable crime. In order to hide his appearance, he was still an escaped convict after all. He grew a thick mustache and what we can only describe as truly magnificent set of mutton chops. The end result was that he was a ringer for Henry Jarvis Raymond, founder of the New York Times and a prominent Republican politician. Worth ditched his own name, and instead of lying low, he went about passing himself off as Henry Judson Raymond, a relative of the great man. When in New York, Worth pulled a big heist, pretending to be a policeman, and then blasted his way into a safe using the knowledge of explosives that he picked up in Sing Sing to net him $30,000. This was his second attempt at the big score. The first was bungled when his brother John, who was a complete inept criminal, screwed the whole job up and almost got them arrested. Adams sent John away, back to Boston, and set about working New York for himself. He found a patron in New York's criminal society, Frederica Mandelbaum, or Marm Mandelbaum to her friends. Marm found jobs and put gangs together. She made heists work, and she was responsible for introducing Adam Worth to Charles Bulliard, who would go on to be his partner and his best friend. Charles was born into money, and he squandered it away, and given the choice of earning or stealing, he took the easier route. He bribed a guard in Hudson River Railroad Express into looking the other way and gave the guard a slight tap on his head. Bulliard got away with $100,000, but investigators thought the injured guard looked suspicious. They sweated him, and he gave up Bulliard's name. The police rounded Charles up, and they threw him in jail to await trial. And that was when Marm Mandelbaum decided to break him out. She hired Adam, and she paired him up with another one of her employees, Max Shinburn. They were tasked with breaking Charles Bulliard out of jail before his trial. Shinburn had already proven his mettle to Marm a year earlier, when he pulled what was at the time the largest heist in history. His team had robbed an Ocean National Bank for over $2.5 million. Adam and Shinburn took turns tunneling Charles Bulliard out of the jail, bribing the guards to turn a deaf ear to the digging sounds. The two men were successful, but their time together caused them to hate each other. For the rest of Adam's time in New York, he and Shinburn were bitter rivals. Adam and Charles, however, became best pals. They decided to work as a team, and they brought a barber shop next to Boylston Bank of America in Boston. The two men, experienced tunnelers, then made their way into the vault via underground and made away with over $450,000 in cash. And if that story sounds familiar, it's also the plot of Sherlock Holmes' story, The Red-Headed League. Soon, every cop in Boston was looking for the men, including the famous Pinkerton agency, the investigators who previously pinched Charles. The two men left Boston that evening for Europe and left their identities behind them. Adam Worth and Charles Bulliard were dead to the world. Instead, Henry Judson Raymond and Charles H. Wells boarded a steamer to the continent. Hi, Steve Gomez here. One of the mandates of the Noir Factory, our mission statement, if you will, is to bring you new episodes of true crime history, noir analysis, and artist profiles regularly to a computer, iPad, or smartphone near you. In addition to that, we've also kept the home fires burning on our website, our Facebook page, as well as on Twitter and Instagram. If you haven't checked those out, I urge you to do so. And in addition to those familiar avenues, we have new and exciting things coming into our future. Although it's way too early to mention them, we're currently hard at work on making plans for and putting the finishing touches on. And you can keep up on everything we do by visiting thenoirfactory.com and signing up for our mailing list. About once a month, we'll shoot you the skinny on and make sure you get a shot at. And we'll never spam you or share your email address with a rival mom. And you can take that to the bank, where my name isn't. And now we return you to this week's crime, already in progress. The first stop for Charles and Adam was Liverpool, where the two men met Kitty Flynn, a 16-year-old barmaid and would-be singer. The two men fell for her, and both of them tried to woo her. Kitty was attracted to both men, so no choice was required on her part. She was aware of both men's past lives of crime and could not have cared less. The partnership instead turned to a threesome, in literally every sense of the word. Kitty shared the affections of both men, even after she went on to marry Charles. and both men seemed perfectly fine with that. In 1871, Kitty and Charles honeymooned in Paris, and they were eventually joined by Adam. It was there that the three of them bought a three-story building a stone's throw away from the Paris Opera House. They christened it the American Bar and sold drinks while it served as a front for a gambling hall, which was illegal in France at the time. Adam liberally bribed the local police, and his gaming tables were constructed so at a moment's notice they can be concealed and patrons could be seen making small talk. The three found some measure of happiness and respectability at the American Bar. Kitty served as a hostess, while Charles greeted, made drinks, drank, and entertained. Adam, as always, was the brains of the enterprise, and he kept things profitable. The American Bar was the place to be for high society for a while, and the upper class would spend their evening hours there after taking in a performance at the Opera House. Adam bribed the local police to give him advance warning of any raids, and soon they were the toast of Paris. But for any establishment like this, inertia has a way of creeping in. And eventually, the American Bar started no longer to be the it place it once was. Gambling houses were starting to lose their novelty, and the beautiful people of Paris no longer flocked to them, and they no longer wanted to spend time in places that could be raided by the police. Instead, thieves and cons made their way to the American Bar. The three had pretty much decided to blow town when an American investigator, one of the illustrious Pinkertons, the agency that had caught Charles and had investigated the Boylston bank job, showed up in Paris. It was one of the principals, either Alan or his son William, and they'd stopped by the American Bar, and they were looking for Adam Worth. Adam, Charlie, and Kitty made their getaway before they were apprehended, and it was said that Adam pinched a few of the customers' diamonds before he left Paris. After their getaway to England, Adam had the assets of the American Bar liquidated for him. Once in England, Adam Worth started to remake himself. He maintained the identity of Henry Judson Raymond, and he bought a grand mansion in Clapton Commons. At the same time, unknown to anyone, Worth leased an apartment in the respectable London neighborhood of Mayfair. Worth kept the two secret identities of his life in London. One was of a gentleman art collector who lived a life of leisure. The other was that of a criminal mastermind in London. Like his role model in New York, Marb Mandelbaum, Adam planned out jobs for his criminal teams, and he put together individuals with complementary talents. He bribed both guards and police, he acquired intelligence on capers, and he made sure that this was all done by intermediaries, so his hands remained spotless. And for this service, he charged 25% of the take, enough to make him wealthy beyond his wildest dreams, but less than anyone else charged. The intermediaries, usually Americans he knew and trusted, ran things for him, and they even included his old rival, Max Shinburne. All parties agreed to Worth's terms, not simply because he was a mastermind, but because Adam Worth, everyone made money. During this time, as the Pinkerton agency still looked for clues on Adam Worth's whereabouts, they put together a pamphlet on him, a sort of profile for their agents. Inside, it listed a description from what they managed to get together, his personal and criminal history, as well as any known associates. The Pinkerton pamphlet described him as a villain, a thief, but at the same time seemed to be very respectful of the man Scotland Yard called the Napoleon of Crime. It even listed the positive traits that Adam Worth possessed. Little Adam Worth, as they called him, was incredibly faithful to his associates, even to the point of placing his own personal wealth or freedom in danger. If a man such as he had credos, one of them was leave no man behind. Little Adam also thought it beneath any criminal, particularly a criminal mastermind, to use force against a victim. He forbade his associates from beating or injuring victims and preferred them not to use weapons of any kind. Even if the Pinkertons had no love for the outlaw, there was a begrudging respect, and it cut both ways. Adam Worth thought of the Pinkerton detectives as true professionals. Adam continued to prosper and spend his wealth, and he worked his way into the center of society while still maintaining his mastermind role. In order to keep his hand in the game, he even pulled a few heists himself. In one long con, he traveled to South Africa and he befriended a postmaster to learn the routes for diamond shippers. He posed as a feather merchant and he spent money lavishly. When the postmaster let his guard down, he had a complete set of copies made from the postmaster's key ring. He made his way back to England aboard his lightning-quick cruiser, with over $500,000 in diamonds in tow. The real challenge for most criminals would have been fencing that much in diamonds, but Adam Worth had that covered as well. Before he even set foot back in England, he'd had one of his lieutenants set up shop as a bargain diamond seller. Once the stock had come in from South Africa, the business boomed. During this time, Adam Worth was at the top of his game, and professionally, he could do no better. Privately, things were a whirlwind. While Kitty and Charles were living in London at the Grand Mansion, Kitty gave birth to two daughters, and she was unsure as who the father was. On top of that, Charles's wife from a previous marriage had tracked him to London, and it had come to light that they'd never divorced. And that was the last straw for Kitty, who left the men and immigrated to New York with her two girls, where she married a wealthy stockbroker. Charles, however, became an alcoholic. For Adam Worth, love came to visit him, and like all personal matters, it was complicated. As Henry Judson Raymond, he met and fell in love with Louise Margaret Bohan, a sweet girl who was the daughter of an innkeeper. He proposed and married Louise Margaret, and they had two children, a boy, Henry, named after his alias, and a girl, Beatrice. And all of this happened without Adam ever revealing his true identity or his criminal activities to her. While there is little doubt of Adam's affections for Louise Margaret, we also know that she was not his true love. That place in Adam Worth's heart was reserved for Lady Georgina Cavendish, the Duchess of Devonshire. In 1876, Adam's brother John, always the incompetent criminal, was arrested and charged for passing forged checks in Paris. His brother had given him a list of banks to avoid, and he had ignored the list. Adam hoped to get his brother out on bail, but Paris at the time, in addition to the money, had a man place his reputation at stake as well. Since Adam was now wanted, under his real name, by both American and European authorities, that simply would not do. Instead, he hatched a plan to force a nobleman to sacrifice both his bail and reputation for his brother. That year, William Agnew had made headlines when he purchased a Thomas Gainsborough painting, Georgiana Cavendish, Duchess of Devonshire, for the unheard-of amount of 10,000 guineas, making it the most expensive painting in the world. It was stored in the London Gallery of Thomas Agnew and Son for 3 weeks, where stories of its authenticity and its history caused even more interest in the painting. The portrait was the toast of London, and all eyes were on it. Worth, along with Jack Junka Phillips and Little Joe Elliott, two of Worth's associates, broke into the gallery and cut the Duchess from her frame. Worth had told the men he planned to sell the painting in a few months, but his actual plan was to hold the painting hostage and force Agnew to sign bail for his brother. The legal team Adam Worth hired for his brother, however, proved sufficient to acquit John of any of the charges. With the painting in his possession, his associates grew anxious for Adam to sell the painting and pay their share, but it was too late for that. Adam Worth had fallen in love with the Duchess. He had a special compartment built under the bed of his cabin in his cruiser so that the Duchess would be with him while he slept. He would often refer to the painting as his mistress, and once even brought a fur coat for her. The painting became his obsession, and his associates did not see the novelty in this behavior. Growing tired of waiting for their cut, Little Joe Elliott lured Worth into a pub and brought him drinks, hoping to get Worth to boast about the Duchess. As the two men drank, Elliott arranged for an undercover officer to listen in. Worth saw through the plan, and he fired Elliott in the spot. He fired him by turning the table over on his head. He left Elliot, and Elliot ran to the police, telling him everything he knew, which was not much, and nothing they didn't already know. Worth was a criminal mastermind, and it was probably true in their thoughts that he held the Duchess. But they had neither proof nor Adam Worth, and they had no idea that Henry Judson Raymond even existed. Adam Worth was at the highest point in his life, but things started to unravel quickly. It started with word from his best friend, Charles Bulliard. He was being held in a Belgian prison, and he was close to death. He was caught working with Max Shinburn, Worth's hated rival from New York, and the two were caught in the middle of a job. While Adam couldn't care less for Max Shinburn, he spent a great deal of wealth trying to buy Charles Bulliard's freedom, to no avail. When that didn't work, he bribed guards to take care of his old friend. Adam traveled to Belgium, and there he learned that Bulliard had died in prison. Perhaps it was out of despair or sadness. Adam pulled a job that was neither well-planned or even necessary, working with Alonzo Henny, a Dutchman, and Johnny Curtin, an American. The three men robbed a money transport. Although the robbery went off without incident, Adam was caught before he could make it out of the country. In custody, he tried to talk his way out of prison, first by saying that there was a mistake, and then admitting to the robbery as a lark. He was later identified as Adam Worth, but strangely, not by the Pinkerton agents who were on his tail and could have easily done so. Instead, he was identified by Max Shinburn, his rival and fellow prisoner. Shinburn had told authorities everything he knew, and he even invented some facts, showing Adam in the most heinous light imaginable. Adam Worth was found guilty of the single crime and sentenced to 7 years in a Belgian prison. Although he still had the Duchess as a bargaining chip, he knew that his empire was done with. In prison, he was beaten severely and regularly by inmates paid by Shinburn. Despite this, he never informed on a single associate. He was hoping to spare his wife, who never knew of any of his criminal activities, any additional shock. He asked Johnny Curtin, the American who worked as his associate on the money transport job, to look in on her and make sure that she was well taken care of. Curtin discovered Adam's wife in London, where he raped her, causing her to suffer an emotional break, and he left her in an asylum. While Adam served his sentence, his friends, for the most part, abandoned him, and his empire was eaten away by his lieutenants. He did receive letters of encouragement, as well as funds to help his situation, from Kitty Flynn, Charles's wife and his former mistress, as well as Mar Mandelbaum, his old patron, but both passed away while he was in prison. Adam was released in 1897, early for good behavior, but prison left him a broken man. He visited his wife, Louise Margaret, in the asylum, but she was unresponsive and she didn't even recognize him. Then he traveled to America to collect his children from his brother, who managed to look after Adam's children with a competency he never had as a criminal. It was said that Adam managed to pay for passage to America by robbing a diamond broker. Once in America, he still had the Duchess, and he was willing to sell her back to her rightful owner for enough money to buy an apartment for himself and his children and retire. But in order to do that, he needed the help of someone he could trust. He needed someone he respected, and who would respect him in turn. He turned to William Pinkerton, the son of Alan Pinkerton and the principal of the Great Detective Agency. While the details aren't known, it's said that Worth received $25,000 for the Duchess. He retired with a clean record, and he moved his children to Regent Park in London and passed a few years later on due to illness. His children went on again to live with their Uncle John, and they received regular funds as well as letters of encouragement from a family friend, William Pinkerton. When Adam's son Henry, named after Adam's alias, was of legal age, he was hired as an investigator with the Pinkerton Agency. Adam Worth was buried under the name Henry Raymond in Highgate Cemetery, but in 1997, he received another headstone, properly identifying him as Adam Worth and giving him the epithet the Napoleon of Crime. After his passing, William Pinkerton, his friend, mourn the loss of the great gentleman thief.
That closes the books on this case. Join us next time on the Wrong Side of the Tracks at the Noir Factory as we look at the best in true crime, noir, and hard-boiled stories has to offer. If you've enjoyed this podcast, then please subscribe on iTunes and leave an honest review. And be sure to stop by the website to fill up on pulpy and hard-boiled goodness. And remember, nice guys finish last.
Psst, still there? This week's special Noir Factory Dakota message is coming right up. Crack the code by visiting thenoirfactory.com/key.
Today's code is 12, 17, 26, 10, 3, 6, 6. That is all. For the key to this code, visit thenoirfactory.com/key. Good night.